all the uncertainty that comes with the global pandemic, one thing is crystal clear. Healthy lifestyles are top of mind. More people care about what they put in their bodies than ever before. The hunt for cleaner eating is on, and organic is the answer. An industry that was already growing rapidly is now bursting at the seams. So how do we cultivate growth responsibly? Expanding demand means expanding borders. New conveniences give way to new technology. Quality ideas that lead to quality food. It's all at our fingertips. And it's all at the Organic Grower Summit 2021, presented by Western Growers. And now, please welcome Organic Produce Network co-founder, Tonya Antle.
And welcome to the 4th Annual Organic Grower Summit. The journey to get here was quite challenging, so on behalf of my partner, Matt Seeley, and the rest of the OPN team, we just want to acknowledge and thank you all so much for supporting us and encouraging us to move forward with this year's summit. So here we are, together, live, to learn, network, and grow our organic businesses together. I truly believe that nothing great happens alone. So I would love to thank the 40 sponsors led by AGCO and Pure Crop One for really helping make this show as successful as possible. And to Dave Puglia for your leadership in understanding that being a presenting sponsor was so important to your industry, to our industry, to everyone. Thank you so much. And I have to tell you, your team, led by Walt, Dennis, and Stephanie, were truly great partners for us in putting together a great show. So this past year, the organic industry saw tremendous, shattering sales. And what was so exciting about that is we saw the industry come together and really meet the moment when it was a dark time in our United States, but we met the moment and we brought beautiful, healthy, organic produce to the market and to consumers across the country. So thank you for doing that. People have asked us, why do you continue to have the show in Monterey County? Well, that's easy. Did you know that California, according to CDFA, has 40% of the producing organic crop acres in the United States? And right now, 10% of California organic land is actually in organic production. And guess which county leads the way? That's right, Monterey County. So I hope that you have learned a lot from our education sessions and picked up some new tools from our sold-out trade show floor. We will be doing that again this afternoon, so we want to thank you for participating. And lastly, I really want to thank the organic farmers that are here today. We really appreciate you coming for 2 days to learn, network, pick up a new supplier, and grow your business, because organic does mean good business. And we all have to remember that it starts with you. Thank you.
Even though Victor P. Smith is more of a just call me Vic kind of guy, his resume reads anything but casual. In his 4-decade career, Vic Smith has been at the helm or a member of most major boards and associations across the industry, including a long-standing relationship with Western Growers. Vic and his father, John, charted an unfamiliar path to growing produce. With Colorado as home base, John was an attorney, with Vic following in his footsteps. But in 1970, John saw an opportunity and made the move to the cooling and distribution business when he started Skyview Cooling. He brought his son into the fold soon after, and the rest, as they say, is history. Bringing an entrepreneurial spirit to the job, Vic focused on innovation, new technology, and expansion. And he went big. Since 1977, Vic and his father formed 7 companies under the J.V. Smith family's name. The diverse group of offerings spans the western United States and Mexico, and includes 32,000 acres of farming, as well as cooling, distribution, and shipping operations. Growing everything from a wide variety of leafy greens to potatoes, carrots, and green onions, Vic Smith has always been on the forefront of new ag tech. Smith was honored in 2017 with the Forbes Impact Award at the Forbes Ag Tech Summit for being a leader in using innovation and technology to meet industry challenges. But for Vic, it doesn't stop with the innovation itself. Smith is a big proponent of investing in the entire ecosystem, focusing on what he has coined the triple bottom line: people, planet, and profit. As for the people component, Vic and his wife Karen created the Smith Family Foundation to ensure donations were being maximized to meet the most community need in all company locations. The foundation also offers scholarship opportunities to children of employees. Vic knows the importance of a well-prepared next generation, as both his son Kyle and daughter Kristen are poised to continue Vic's legacy of success for decades to come.
Takes a certain kind of person to farm this land. There are the kind who say, this is the way we've always done things. Then there are those fearless ones who see every seed, acre, and piece of equipment as an opportunity to upend expectations. Those are the ones who don't just have a farm, but run a business. Who treat every row-tilled, hour logged, and crop harvested like their bottom line depends on it. Because it does. So they don't stand around hoping for the best. Instead, they run the best in the field. Like machines that don't just meet the demands of the job, but beat them. The kind that put an emphasis on performance, not paint color. And ones that can be trusted to be there for the long haul. Those are the ones who turn to Fendt. Because every day, every season is out there for the taking. But only for those who are ready to grow bold.
And now, please welcome to the stage AGCO Director of Dealer Performance for North America, Greg Milstead, to present this year's Grower of the Year Award.
She thinks my tractor's sexy. Yeah, well, it turns her on.
Thank you for that. That was a great song. Yeah, thank you for that. Yeah, that's her fault, not mine. No, thank you for letting us be here today. It's been the fourth year, actually fifth year. It was good to see Vernon. Vernon was the first recipient of the award. The second one was Thaddeus Barsotti. I don't know if he's here today. Third one was Grant Lundberg, and it's an honor to present Vic Smith for our fourth one for the Organic Grower of the Year, sir. Please, come up.
Oh, it's heavy.
Yeah, it's heavy. His name's a lot easier to pronounce than Thaddeus. I'll say that. So. we're gonna do something a little different. This is Tanya's idea and Matt's idea. Instead of just doing a quick presentation, have a little bit of a one-on-one discussion. We thought y'all would get some good value out of some questions and some insight from Vic's experience over 40 plus years in the industry. So. You want to have a seat, sir, or you want to say a few things?
If I could just take, you know, I'm very brief with all my comments. So
I'm going to come over here and sit.
And if I go over 90 minutes, please cut the mic off. But I am here to accept this award, very beautiful one, heavy. But this, I'm accepting this on behalf of the group of people that manage our operations and all the people that are involved in our operations from, you know, irrigators and tractor drivers. It takes a team and it takes leaders. I'm accepting this on behalf of them because there's no way we could do what we do without a great effort. So I do have to mention a few names here. And we have Josh Roberts running our California operations. We have Matt McGuire in Arizona who oversees all farming operations. Chad Van Meter runs Yuma. We have, you know, Fernando in Mexico, Amy Kanugi in Colorado. These are great people. They're the ones that get the job done. And we couldn't grow it if we didn't have, we couldn't have started and we couldn't have grown it if we didn't have support. The people that wanted it, that did a great job marketing it. And so we got involved when we started growing organic. We got involved early with Pacific International Marketing Group, Pure Pacific, Earthbound Farms. Taylor Farms obviously came in and became quite a factor in it, but great companies, Nunes Company, other ones that are just do a tremendous job. So with their support, this is why I get to hold this. So thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
So we're going to spend just a few minutes just kind of getting some insights from Grant, or excuse me, from Vic. And I think one of the first questions we had kind of talked about was, you know, what are the things when you look at your operation spread over, you know, tens of thousands of acres, even two countries or multiple countries, multiple states, what keeps you up at night?
Mostly caffeine, but you weren't interested in that. No, I got that. You know, there's the typical, you know, you talk about, in our industry, you talk about, well, West, you talk about water.
Yeah.
You know, and you talk about labor. We're very labor intense. We're trying to, as the labor goes down, we're not able to secure more labor. We have to mechanize, so that's important. But then you talk about regulations. And I'm not one, the big government, I don't want any government, believe me. I want government to be there and guarantee that everybody that's producing and delivering to our customers, ultimately the consumers, to be there and guarantee so they have, you know, they can feel comfortable, our consumers on any shelf where they pick up any of our product, that they're comfortable with it. I don't want to pay taxes, but that, I agree with and the government. So anyway. It's those issues, and then, you know, who knows what the issue of the day will come, but
right.
Every day, but those are chronic, those are perpetual issues.
Yeah, you know, we hear that across North America, and especially the labor piece and the regulation piece.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think from a manufacturing standpoint or any agribusiness, you know, one of the things that keeps us up at night is, you know, the profitability and sustainability of the end user.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think, Tony, you brought it up a little bit in terms of what last year did with the ag industry, and it certainly spotlighted it. It spotlighted it how fragile it could be, particularly in the food chain, you know, and we saw it with things like meat processing. You know, and you're used to going to the grocery store, and now you can only get one piece of meat. We've never seen that before. And so I think it really brought together a lot of the things that what keeps us up at night is the sustainability of the food chain, particularly as it relates to the growers being profitable.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's important. You know, it's not in this, you know, just do it. We've got to generate a profit to deliver a better product to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
So, but the labor thing has been remarkable, particularly as we look at equipment, trying to automate equipment, and we've seen some videos of that. That's probably the next phase of agriculture that's just prime for, I think, that space is that kind of automation, even though everybody thinks it might be an automobile. I think it's mostly in, mm-hmm. In agriculture. So,
right, yeah. I agree. And I'm hoping for more, faster, you know,
yeah, for
innovation.
Sure. You know, when you look back at the 40 years, what's been one of the single most impactful innovations you've seen in agriculture?
Ooh, in agriculture, you know, you've got automation, you've got, you know, the marketing side. It's all integrated. We all need to come together, but... you know, the sustainability factor, as you get into it, is to me is fascinating because we have to understand this whole ecosystem, mm-hmm. and everything, and that's why I like organic farming. And a special shout out to Israel Morales Sr., who I had the opportunity to work with and form the company, and yes, very deservedly opportunity to work with. And so I'm going to reverse that on you and say, hey, before we get more innovative, we've got to come back and understand our total ecosystem. And we got to learn from that because we tend to go off in a direction, you know, boom, 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 and build bigger, better, faster. But there's other ways to approach it. And I had the great honor of working with Israel for at least 7 or 8 years. And he basically managed to explain to me in a very holistic manner, you know, you have to understand the roots of the situation. And that's a pun intended. And so that was, to me, that was great, which heads me now into the future things and looking at it. So,
Yeah, I think I look back and, you know, I remember being in a combine with my granddad, and he was so fascinated by the GPS that it could follow it. And you look at the history there, and now we're trying to optimize not an acre of ground, but almost a square, not even a square foot.
We're getting much more precision.
Everything that goes into that ground or how you maximize the yield, whether it's in corn, soybeans, certainly anything vegetable produced, but it's remarkable the technology that we're seeing today. And we've showed a few videos of even some of the things that are yet to come, whether it be with automation or robotics or things of that nature. But I think agriculture is on the forefront of technology, just as space travel, things like that. And so to me it's almost like the Dick Tracy. You look at people now that have your iWatch and you're talking into your watch and you can see somebody that's in another country.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just fascinating to me. Yeah. So I think agriculture will continue to get there. You know, we've even heard things around genetics with seeds and things like that, where there's the possibility of growing corn in the Sahara Desert. I mean, think about those kind of things and how you feed the world with that kind of technology. And so that to me is the thing that kind of, I just go, wow, that's remarkable.
Yeah.
That's remarkable. You know, when you think about maybe shifting gears a little bit into the organic piece, you know, what's your take on the good, the bad, and the ugly?
Well, some people, when you say that term, good, bad, and ugly, there may be, a famous actor comes to mind. But my experience, and that's what I used to think until I went to my first eco conference in Asilomar, in a beautiful area, mid-90s, and we check in this beautiful lodge, and the grower that actually convinced us we had to start growing organics has been a good friend and a great grower, but he's as redneck as they come from in Yuma. And so we walk into this lodge and, you know, we get our badges and I said, well, let's go mingle. And I said, you're bound to know somebody. I'll go this way, you go that way. And we circulate, boom. No, anybody. And I look at him and I said, you know what? I think we need to go outside and smoke a joint because I don't think we're gonna blend. And I'm half kidding, but half serious, because that was, if you know, you have to read the audience. But let me finish quickly, and I digress. And there was a speaker after the luncheon, and a real nice guy, I remember from Minnesota, and very educated, very, articulate. And so we're sitting there listening to his speech, and his speech was entitled "The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly." Yeah, so that's curious. So he says, hey, goes on, the good is the organics catching on. You know, once again, mid-90 context. It's starting to take hold, people recognize it. The bad is that corporate farming is coming in, and they're just gonna ruin it for all of us. You know, my 2-acre parcel here is gonna be, and hey, there's markets for everything. We don't, you know, we don't try and ruin anybody. We're trying to grow the base. But the ugly is the corporate farmers going to Mexico. Now, I'm holding a badge that says Vic Smith, you know, from Promotora Agricola El Toro, Incorporated. So that those were early years and a lot of transition. So
anyway. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you know, I look at, and we've talked about this every year, I just watch the market share in the grocery stores of organic growing and organic foods, and it's quite remarkable. And then I open up our refrigerator and I go, wow, I mean, it's 30% easy, whereas probably 5 years ago, probably wasn't any.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, probably wasn't any. But I was talking to a young lady here that you'll see here in a little bit, and I'm just fascinated by I live in Atlanta, and it's just amazing the market share on the shelves, and you can see it as plain as day, and how many more people are being educated by it, and I think this conference is certainly one of those that helps with that. But the marketing of it has been remarkable, and I think that's a good thing. Yeah, I think that's a good
thing. Thank
you. Yeah, I think that's
a good thing. We appreciate that. And I've got some studies going on. We're pretty convinced that organic spinach will be an effective deterrent to COVID, and even with the new variety. new variant.
Who knows?
Just a slight pitch. Follow the media.
You know, you've done both conventional farming and certainly organic farming, and I got to believe there's lessons that you've learned between both. One going from one to the other, another to the one. What would those be?
Well, and once again, when we got in there, it was early stages. So, you know, there wasn't a lot of real knowledge like we could go to an ag extension or, you know, my neighbor and, you know, and talk about, you know, what do you do for this? What do you do for that? So, you know, the conference I went to while I held my over my badge, you know, you had to kind of go and kiss. The gentleman's name was Amigo Bob. And he was about the most knowledgeable source that anybody knew. Well, you could go talk to Amigo Bob. So he'll fit you in, you know. I mean, and then since then, I think I've learned a lot more than what we got out of that. But to me, it was the merging of conventional and organic. So conventional and, you know, the years we'd been farming with that, we knew what kind of the best equipment to, you know, do and precision to plant it and grow it properly. Irrigation techniques, we had that. When it came to, okay, what are we going to use for pesticides and fertilizers? You know, there, at that time there wasn't anything really in a pesticide world, but fertilizer was still an unknown, how much units you could get from here and there. And that's another thing I learned from my dear friend Israel Morales, is how you could monitor those things. And I'm probably not right with this because I'm not the actual grower. I think we learned that we could grow the same quality organic romaine hearts at about one third of the units of nitrogen coming from a natural source than it took us to do conventional, and we were convinced that's all we had to have, mm-hmm. you know. And so, you know, and that goes back to innovations of being able, we're going to have to get much more precise in all inputs and right. measure and all that. So, you know, the cross between the two basically brought us together. We're over here, you know, organic was you can't use anything, da-da-da-da, and we don't trust any conventional growers, and we're going over there. What are you idiots doing, you know? We're going to come in and take over the world. And we learned right away, we didn't, between weeds and fertilization. But we merged knowledge, and we searched for knowledge together. And I saw kind of meeting in the middle. They're at, you know, meeting this side saying, you got to do it this way and that way. I remember one lady at the conference screaming, why are we letting chlorine to be used on organic product? And the guy that led it said, lady, it's the same, we only allow the same as what's in your drinking water. And yeah. She was livid, then I want it, you know, we're gonna have to refine it out. And so we finally got together, merged together, and it was a good learning experience. So I think the small farmers were able to learn from us. Our organization was able to learn quite a bit from that methodology mm-hmm. and the organic system plans you use.
Yeah, it's a fascinating balance. You know, you think how Mother Nature and the Earth, they're regenerative and how they become regenerative, and there's ways to have that balance that I think, when you look across the landscape of agriculture, certainly in North America, I think it's gonna find its way more and more. And one of the things that may do it this year is the price of nitrogen right now, fertilizer. It's crazy.
I was just thinking that when you said it because I just thought I wished everything was organic because yeah. what they're doing for synthetic fertilizer is insane.
It's expensive. It is expensive. Yeah. It is expensive. You know, we talked a lot about change and the innovations and what you learned from one over the other. What, in your opinion, what do you see in this business something that won't change?
Well, and that's, you're asking the wrong guy because, you know, I'll give you 10 projections and 9.5 of them are wrong. You know, they won't prove out. But you know, assuming I might know something, then I would say that, you know, you look at that and say, what's not going to change? Well, if you're going to be a grower, you have to work hard. I mean, that's just, you know, the work ethic for people we want to hire, we will pay whatever the market is plus more because once we find somebody, we want to adopt them. We want to be part of the family. But the work ethic, the commitment to those things, and it's a kind of a paradox here when you say, what won't change? And I would say that, you know, if we don't have an innovative attitude to change, you know, that's what won't change, is you have to have that attitude and that optimism and enthusiasm to adapt to new and different situations, and don't lose that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, that open-mindedness is a big deal, you know, whenever he's trying to find a better way to do something, because mostly there is. I know my dad and I talk a lot about the business. He was in it forever, and I'm convinced of this, is that, you know, the one thing I don't think will change is this not being a relationship business. I think agriculture will always be a relationship-driven business, a firm handshake, your word means something, because you're tied to the oldest profession on the planet. You know, so why would you want to do anything to fracture that?
Yeah.
So
your answer is much better than mine. And I agree with you.
I thought about it because I wrote the question. So. Now we got a few minutes left. Just one more. You know, when you look out at the audience here and you think about your tenure and all the things and all the people that you've interacted with, you know, what would be the one thing you'd like to leave with them? I always kind of think of the movie City Slickers, you know, when Curly was going, what's the one thing, you know, to Billy Crystal?
The one thing.
What would be the one thing you would tell this audience?
Well, if you're younger and, you know, starting out in the business, get out. That's the first thing, because, and I'll go back to, you know, prior answer, but, you know, it's volatile, it's crazy. You're dealing with Mother Nature, you're dealing with, no offense, God bless you, we need you, Walmart, Kroger, and everybody else, but it ain't easy. They sell it, and you deal with them, and hey, they make us, you know, if they'll market it, we get it. But, you know, I think it's just, one thing I'd say is, I've been in this thing for longer than I want to admit, and I've had ups, fair amount of downs, backups, so it's a bipolar. It'd help if you're bipolar. And it, but, you know, I've never been bored. And I've never, I get up and I think, if I had to sit at a desk all day, and I do too much of that, but if I had to sit there and didn't have the opportunity and grow out and meet people, and that's just so, it's got its pluses, but if you're young enough, take the first advice. And you know, but anyway, but when you leave, buy organic.
Yeah, that's a good one. You know, if you're in agriculture, Tanya, you kind of mentioned, why is this always in Monterey County? And, you know, as I travel North America and you look at all the different kinds of agriculture, when you come here, there is nothing in the world like it. I'm here to tell you, when I go to Iowa, if anybody's from Iowa, I apologize. It's boring. You look at corn and soybeans and corn and soybeans. When you come out here, it's just fascinating to me to see the agriculture you guys are involved with, the farming that you do, even down in Yuma and those areas as well. And if you don't get excited about coming out to see this part of the world, when you're tied to agriculture, you're in the wrong business. You're in the wrong business.
Exactly.
So, thank you for having me here. Thank you for everything.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for the award.
Yeah, congratulations.
And your participation.
Yeah. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
The next three people you're about to meet are pioneers in their own right, charting unfamiliar courses as they take their family-grown operations into a new era of organics. Keith Barnard is the Senior Vice President of Sales and Sourcing for Mission Produce. Rising through the ranks quickly because of his keen understanding of global markets, Barnard is known for his ability to identify, navigate, and grow emerging sources. Through his decade of experience, he has fostered key relationships to build markets, supporting additional access of fruit for customers and opportunities for growers. Mike Valpredo is a third-generation farmer from the center of California's agricultural heartland. As president of Country Sweet Potato, Mike moved to a vertical integration model when he incorporated the company and created the Baco Sweet brand shortly after. Mike continues the proud legacy of protecting the land by perfecting the process of reinvigorating their soils as they continue to focus on a growing organic operation. Bianca Caprellian might seem like the new kid on the block to some, but she is anything but green when it comes to growing flavor-packed quality fruit. The Fruit World co-founder grew up on a multi-generational stone fruit and citrus farm,
learning all parts of the operation. After time away from ag, Caprellian studied ecological horticulture and launched her career in produce buying. Interacting with growers again ignited her commitment to her heritage. Now she and her business partner are poised to be the next generation's brightest stars. This dynamic discussion will be led by Western Growers Association President and CEO Dave Puglia. For more than 15 years, Puglia has been at the forefront of major legislative issues facing growers, tackling topics like water, energy, and labor. With a pedigree in California politics and a deep understanding of issues facing Western agriculture, Puglia's insightful perspective rounds out the conversation. Please give a warm welcome to these next generation organic leaders.
Well, good morning, everybody. I'm pleasantly surprised that all three of these younger generation organic leaders walked up on the stage after Vic made a compelling case for them to go out those doors and never come back. So I thank you all for hanging in there. Hopefully after today, you'll still be involved in the industry despite Vic's advice. I've been looking forward to this discussion very much. This is not only an opportunity to focus on the next generation as through the lens of organic production, but through the lens of organic and conventional and agriculture in the larger sense. As someone who's been kicking around this industry for a little while, didn't grow up in agriculture, I'm really enthusiastic about what I have seen and learned from the upcoming generations, all due respect to those who have come before. Vic is something of a mentor to me, so I don't want to take anything away from him or from his colleagues. But I think this generation has an opportunity and really an obligation to look at everything fresh and to dispense with some of the maybe legacy baggage that prior generations have brought into the tough conversations we have around public policy, especially in agriculture. So really appreciate having the opportunity to be part of this with the three of you and look forward to the conversation. I think it'd be really interesting to hear all of you share a little bit about what brought you into the industry. We got a bit of that from the video introductions and your biographies, but I know, for example, Vic's advice to run away, I know at least one of you also got that advice from a parent. So if you would just share a little bit about what brought you into the industry or what brought you back to the industry. Keith?
Yeah, for me, I think it's fair to say I was forced into the industry. Opposite of Vic's, message. I got the, you're gonna come here. But I graduated college in 2008, and that was when the industry was a little bit in shambles, the whole economy, and also when the avocado growers started doing the GAP certifications long after the whole spinach deal. So we didn't really know what we were doing, and I certified our family's ranches, not knowing what I was doing then either, but Mission needed somebody to kind of take it on a global scale, so I got nominated, and the VP at the time, Jim Donovan, offered me a job, and that's where I am.
Cool. Bianca?
Yes, so I was the one that was pushed out. My dad was kind of like Keith. He was forced into the business, and he wanted to make sure that his kids were not. So he said, get out of here, Vic's advice. Get out of here. Don't do this. This is hard. And so I left agriculture. I went to the East Coast. I went to college. I had a first career totally unrelated to ag, and really over those few years after college started feeling the pull back to my agricultural roots. I knew that I wanted to be involved in the family business somehow, didn't know what that meant. I ended up coming back to California and deciding that the best way to move forward would be to go study sustainable agriculture. And so I attended the UC Santa Cruz Agroecology Program, where I lived on the farm, took classes with our cohort, and it was pretty funny. My dad said, okay, so hold on, you are going to pay to go learn how to farm when you can come home and I will pay you to farm with me. But I knew that I wanted to do things differently than my family, and that if I was going to be a part of the business, that I needed to gather some of my own knowledge. And so that is what I did. After that, I wasn't quite ready to come back to the family farm, so I started out as a buyer at Veritable Vegetable, moved on to be a buyer at Whole Foods, and I loved buying. But one day I got a call from my dad, and he said, the large marketing company that had been representing my family's citrus crop and was the primary customer for my family's packing house, they decided to get out of the California citrus deal. So my family lost their packing house customer, they lost their sales and marketing company, and my dad called and he said, it's your time. You've got this. You've been talking about wanting to come back. Here's your opportunity. So CJ, my business partner, CJ Buxman, and I started talking, similar stories. We started talking and we said, let's do this thing together. We started Fruit World 5 years ago now, and it was really a way to take back control of our family farming business. Mm-hmm. Our goal was to continue, make sure that we could continue into future generations. And the great thing is, over the last 5 years, we've had growers who we grew up with call us and say, hey, we love what you're doing. Can we be a part of this in some way? So we represent 10 growers now, family growers that share our values. And we feel like the sky's the limit. We're really excited about the future.
That's terrific. Great story. Michael?
It's 2 out of 3 that got to get out of here. Because, Vic, you were channeling your inner Don Valpredo. And my dad told me, you know, growing up in Bakersfield and being row crop growers there at the southern end of the San Joaquin Valley, how tough it was. And I saw it firsthand. You know, we were growing carrots and potatoes and bell peppers and, you know, those rotational watermelons, you know, the things you grow in Bakersfield, and tough years, really tough. So I never saw myself through my education or my profession being in the industry. But eventually I was actually in the media business and was living back east. And it started in the early 2000s. You could see some of my friends, Randy Jamara and some of the others, started to get into the industry, and they were going to trade shows and they were talking about the innovation and some of the great stuff. My dad, of course, with Western Growers. Hearing some of these stories, I started to think about, is there a role for me to play in the family business? And actually put together a business plan in 2006, which my dad told me was a terrible idea. And actually, I had to get my wife involved a little bit. We had just gotten married, and she came out. She was in pharmaceutical sales, had an opportunity to move out to California. So my dad said yes, and the organic part of our business really started very small. We had 40 acres, but it was the first thing that I could represent for us. And I went into a Whole Foods in Santa Monica, and they were really, at that time, showcasing local growers. And I went to this Whole Foods, and I talked to the produce manager, and I asked for a name and a number, and he gave me the name to Joe Kovacovich and Mark Wilson, who were down at the SOPAC office down there in East LA, and they let me come in. I just bugged the crap out of these guys. Twice a week, I would just go sit in their office and really beg them for POs. And I think I just, at some point, they were like, all right, fine, just send us 3 pallets. Our first order was for cantaloupes, and they rejected them. And I'll never forget that phone call. But, you know, things and time went on, and we eventually have transitioned most of our ground and most of our acres, and the majority of our business now is about being organic growers there south of Bakersfield.
So a question, as you've matured the organic line, Michael, in your case especially, but for all of you, we've all talked about the growth of consumer demand for organic. You have your own relationships with the buyers in this industry. I'm curious what, because Michael, one of you just mentioned sustainability. I'm curious how you see the question of sustainability marrying up to or being separate from organic as a consumer preference, and how the buyers are projecting that back to all of you as producers. I think there's a little bit of anxiety in the industry about whether the organic brand and the value behind the term might be supplanted by or eroded by a sustainability program that takes hold, you know, on a broad scale through the industry. So curious all your thoughts on that. Why don't we start with you, Bianca?
I can start. I don't see it as a either or. What I'm really seeing is an and. And I think as we see that organic consumers are becoming more savvy and they are wanting to see, I feel like there's some sustainability baked into the to the organics, but consumers are starting to ask for more. They're wanting to see, show me how this is sustainable, and pushing for a little more. And so I really see it as an and, not an or. I don't think it's going to replace organics. I think that we're going to want to push the organic envelope further. I think that we might see some additional accreditations start, because really what the National Organic Program gave us was a set of standards to all follow. So really it showed consumers that this is what this label means. And I think that we're going to start seeing more and more of that with sustainability. Sustainability is a great word, but what does it mean? How do I as a consumer know, okay, you're saying this is sustainable, so is this guy, well, what does that mean? So I think we'll start to see whether that's baked into organic certification or additional certifications. I think we're gonna start to see that push for the and.
Keith?
Yeah, I would agree. In the avocado industry, we see, you know, organics as a lifestyle, healthy choice for our consumers. And then on the sustainability end, we're seeing it as everyone's responsibility. And for us, I think a lot of our growers do the sustainable thing, but they haven't been documenting it. So that's the key from our end, telling our story and putting it in a you know, written format to prove that we are doing the right thing. But you know, we look at it as different, but they definitely can merge together.
Yeah, and for us, you know, we deal so much with rotation, and it's really about taking care of the dirt and making sure that, you know, we are replenishing the soil. But we have to. It is part of our survival to do that. And we tell that story, which is really the truth. That's what's so great about what story we tell. I agree with Bianca. I think the standards need to be set there, but once they are, and those, you know, definitions are clear, that all of us are effectively achieving that sustainability, because that is ultimately our survival.
You know, the earlier panel discussion with Walt and Vani and Shauna, there was a little bit of discussion around this. And specifically, I think, you know, Vani made the point, which I agree with strongly, that one of the things that kind of holds back the specialty crop industry, agriculture generally, but certainly specialty crop industry, is that we don't have direct engagement large scale with consumers. We do through certain small channels, but really the relationship between the consumer and our products is controlled by, for lack of a better word, the retailers and the food service buyers. But all of you are of a different generation that is maybe less intent on staying, you know, eyes in the dirt and staying on the farm and not engaging with broader communities. So tell me a little bit about what experiences you've had or that you've embarked upon, to your point, Michael, to be able to spread knowledge without having to go through the filter of somebody in between yourself and your consumer.
So we have tried to do the opposite, as I think from, and with all due respect, my dad's generation, which was to keep a lot of, not secrets, but not really stand up from the mountaintop and really want to broadcast your family story. I think that we went to retailers and said, we want you to know about us. We want you to come to our farm. We want you to see, we are proud of the way we do business. We're wide open. You know, we don't have factory doors that we can close. In our case, we're actually right along the freeway. So, you know, whether the news wanted to come out and do a story or a retailer wanted to do a profile, we wanted to give them all of that collateral that we could. We organized it. We took videos. We went to Whole Foods specifically and said, come to us, bring your cameras, bring your people. You're all invited anytime you want to be here. But to me, it was about really kind of flipping that a mindset that maybe people were a little tentative before, where I think we just got really proud to tell everybody that we want you to come and see us.
Yeah, I would agree that telling our story is so important. And we were just talking about this before. Before the session started, that during the pandemic, it was really fun to get to do video tours for our customers. and really open up. And you know, you might get one or two buyers out at any given time to come visit the farms, but to get to have a Zoom call and have, you know, 20 plus people from one of your customers' companies get to see your operation from start to finish was really amazing. And just really helps, telling our story helps give our customers that ammunition to then go out and tell our story to their end consumers. And one thing that we're doing that's really cool is we have some grapes, Tom Cord grapes, and it's a really special grape. We have a small plot of them. Farmers, when you hear this, don't take it as happy ears and think you should go plant a bunch of Tom Cord grapes. Please don't. it's a special grape. We grow about 15 acres of it, and in every consumer package, we put a little business card size piece of paper that tells our story and why we decided to grow this grape, and it gives a phone number and invites the end consumer to text us. And it's a 15-acre block, so this works. It's an 8-week season. We can do this. We respond to every single text message. And so it's kind of all hands on deck for our little team during that 8-week season. We respond to everybody, and the responses that we get are amazing. This grape has Concord in it, and so it's an old variety grape, and we get all these stories of people saying, this grape reminds me of my childhood. Keep farming. Thank you for doing this. We get pictures of people send us of their children eating the grapes. We've only received a few R-rated pictures. Most of the time it's kids eating the grapes, it's people telling their stories. And the cool thing is, we just finished our fourth season with this grape, and we now have people who couple weeks before have saved this phone number and will reach out to us and say, when are these grapes starting up? We get people, where can I buy more? We're out at my local store. And so that has been a really cool way to connect with the end user. And I think what people want is, we hear this over and over, they want stories. They want to feel good about what they're buying. Yeah. And so really opening those doors and sharing our stories is valuable for the organic industry as a whole.
You can go together.
Yeah, I mean, these guys said it pretty well, but I'll piggyback on Mike's, you know, open door policy. Mission operates in 9 countries and 11 states. So, you know, we have an open invite to any buyer anywhere in the world that will take them and show them, you know, what we're doing, show them the solar, show them the automation. And that really goes a long way for them to, you know, pass it down to the consumer. And then we have a full marketing team that really follows the farmers around and, you know, markets exactly what they're doing. So just to piggyback Mike a little bit.
Yeah, I think that this kind of leads to a discussion about transparency and transparency relative to consumers, transparency relative to policymakers, which we can talk about a little bit. Not to brag on Western growers, but related to Bianca, what you're doing, I think it's awesome. I love that. Didn't know that. Several years ago, we put a lot of energy and resources into our social media efforts through our communications folks, who are fortunately younger than I am and very smart and very, very capable. A very simple strategy, which was to showcase our members, not with overproduced videos, but just very genuine, unscripted glimpses into what they do, how they do it, why they do it that way, across all kinds of different commodities. And if I had the chart that showed you the number of video views on Facebook over time, it just goes like this. It's incredible. And we have tracked where those videos are being viewed. It's Facebook, it's Instagram, it's Twitter as well. When we started out, predictably, most of the video views were coming from this area, from Yuma, from Santa Maria, from the San Joaquin Valley, very little from urban Southern California or urban Northern California or Phoenix. Today, it's almost the majority now coming from urban Southern California and from the Bay Area and from Phoenix. And that's exactly what we were hoping for and shooting for, was to, you know, talk directly to ordinary people, to our consumers, and let them understand what we do and why we do it that way. And I think, you know, if everybody did more of that, again, what you're doing, I think is remarkable, because it gives us a chance to but to have a direct discussion with consumers, rather than, as I said earlier, going through a filter. So That's cool stuff. And again, I think it's something that every successive generation will get better at, I'm expecting. So a question for you here as the story you just told about the proprietary grape, Bianca. What's your mindset in new product development and new varietals and new value add products? You know, this industry, the special crop industry, has been defined really by its lean in towards innovation and product development and value add. So share, if you can, some of your thoughts about where you want to take your companies in terms of new product development, or are you partnering with others outside the walls of your company, maybe in other countries? Curious what you see there. Either one, go ahead.
Okay. So I was listening to Ben Hartman from Good Eggs at the previous session, and what he was talking about was more specialty items and how especially organic consumers seem to be more interested in specialty items. We are definitely seeing that, and that's a direction that we're going. We primarily sell organic citrus, and what we've seen in the citrus industry as a whole is getting away from naming varieties. And, you know, it's a bag of mandarins. So we've gotten away from naming all the varieties that are in those bags of mandarins. What we're seeing now is kind of a return to consumers wanting to know, well, what variety is this? And so we're starting to share with consumers the variety, trying to label that a little bit more. And we're investing and planting more specialty items. So we're doing a lot of specialty citrus, different kinds of quats, different kinds of lemons. I think that there's a lot of room for growth there. To me, that's exciting stuff. Also, in terms of grapes, we're looking at some heritage varieties that are being updated. And so some of these, it's like the Tomcord is a great example. It has that great Concord flavor, but it's seedless, doesn't have a slip skin. So definitely looking forward there. I think packaging innovation is also huge, and we might talk about that a little more later. But just trying to get, in terms of sustainability, get on top of, especially during the pandemic, we saw a lot of customers wanting packaged items. As we were starting to get away a little bit from packaged items, pull back into packaging, that's a lot of plastic. How do we get into more sustainable forms of packaging?
Yeah, so for our business, and sweet potatoes is our main commodity, we are totally focused on value add and on packaged singles, steam bags, doing different varieties through packaged goods. We saw the same thing with the pandemic. Our item, like several items, is a heavy bulk item. Typically 80-90% of the category was sold bulk. We are right now trending at 50-50. So 50% of what we are selling now is a packaged item. We're getting a lot of push from retailers to make our packaging now sustainable. So that's gonna be the next wave. Retailers are definitely, and the technology and some of the new packaging products that are out there are definitely going in that direction. So it is 1,000% what we look at as our differentiator. It's what we wanna be the best at. And I think, you know, the specialty items are really what, at least for us, excites us about the future.
There's a little bit of a sustainability conflict there, right? I mean, traditionally a bulk item, now demand is for a single package, microwavable, as you said, a lot more packaging. So how do you, I mean, packaging changes, I guess, are part of the answer, and you both hinted to that. So
yeah.
You're seeing the same?
Yeah, it's a funny story. So we went into Europe about 6 years ago, and my dad, being the guy he is, if you know him, thought he could go
those
into
were very carefully chosen words.
Yeah. Vic can tell you. But, you know, he went into the European market thinking he could change the entire industry by bulk 25-pound lug into all retail. And we fought that for 6 years. And I framed an email about 3 months ago that he actually admitted that he was wrong and that we need to start buying some repackaging material. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're talking one avocado in a pack. So to your point, Europe's really keen on sustainability, but then they use more plastic than anyone in the world. So, you know, I think Europe tends to, and avocados, follow the US probably 20-25 years later. So yeah, we just watch the innovation and right now, you know, try to move volume and adapt to the consumer.
So I want to tease out one more question on this because it loops into public policy. California has been debating a single-use plastic phase-out via legislation now for several years. The bill keeps getting sidetracked, and for good reason. It's not well-baked. But how much would you, let me ask it this way. If California were to impose a fairly rapid phase-out of single-use plastics and other packaging, is that something you would actually prefer rather than be opposed to? Because it forces the issue. It forces capital to come in and look at alternatives. You're already on the path, it sounds like, but that would be a leveling of the playing field.
What would the solid guys say?
Yeah, well, I know what they would say because I get those calls.
Right. So I'm thinking they'll figure something out before
They say we need to be exempted for food safety reasons. We have a food safety imperative that requires this material. So, okay, but that's not everybody in this industry, right? So I'm just curious how you, because this kind of goes to the larger question about your collective openness or receptiveness to mandates imposed by either state government or the federal government that your prior generations may have said, no, hell no, stay out of our business. But, you know, you can make a case, and I'm not necessarily making it here because I like my job, I don't want to get fired, that sometimes a regulatory mandate that anticipates where the market's probably going to go anyway is, you know, it's a good thing because, again, it forces capital to come in. There's an opportunity now to rush a solution into the marketplace.
Totally. Yeah, I mean, I think if that's what happens, they're going to have to fast track. And being at this show, you see the science, the technology, the brain power, the investment. I mean, that's what's so great. I was talking to Tonya last night about that's why this show is so important. I mean, the sales show, everybody wants to come, you know, and sell it. That's fun. But this innovation and the growing and looking at the technology is really, so I'm kind of answering your question, but I'm thinking we all are going to have to get together. And seriously, anyone has Bruce Taylor, call him, ask him, because they're thinking of this and they see this coming. So to your point, I don't think it's necessarily the worst thing, provided we have enough time to prepare for it and our businesses are ready.
I agree with Mike. We are seeing, for example, in grapes, we moved from 100% plastic packaging in grapes to over the past 3 years. I think this year we were about 10% plastic packaging in grapes. So in that world, we've been able to pretty quickly move out of plastic packaging. In the citrus world, I think that we're on the hunt for some cost-effective non-plastic packaging, and I feel like we're at the cusp. We're getting close. So I think that by the time it happens, we'll be ready.
Stepping back from packaging now for a minute, curious because Keith mentioned the Europeans and their overuse of plastic, but the EU has a very strict sense of things with respect to sustainability. I'm curious where you see your businesses either lining up with. Are you keeping an eye on where EU policy goes on sustainability and trying to keep pace? Or is U.S. production going to kind of sort of go its own way? And who ultimately dominates that space? Is it EU? Is it North America? Some combination?
For us, it's a little bit difficult because we operate in so many countries that we, you know, have to have the European market. You know, they go a little extreme with Rainforest Alliance and all this, you know, BS stuff, but I think, unfortunately, we have to play in that game because we can't ship all our avocados to the United States. It's just not possible. So we, as much as my dad hates it, we are playing the game.
We deal quite a bit in Canadian retail, so I kind of look at them as European light. They're definitely ahead of us. So I continually ask our Canadian retailers like what they're going to expect or demand of us. I sense it's coming, but I don't, they're not knocking. The pandemic kind of paused a lot. It felt like that there was a lot of legislative ideas that were moving forward, and we had kind of a year and a half to just let's make sure everybody has enough food and we keep the store shelves, you know, stocked appropriately. But For us, at least, we're really waiting for Loblaw and Sobeys to tell us what we're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, similar experience to Mike.
Yeah.
Prior panel, again, there was a little bit of discussion about controlled environment ag, CEA. Curious your thoughts on that. I think my colleague Walt Duflock, who's probably in the room here somewhere, teed that up very well, which is, you know, you can view that as a threat as an outdoor grower to be displaced, or perhaps as an opportunity to at least take part of your business and morph it into a CEA model, which requires a ton of capital, obviously. So curious if you've had any thought about where CEA might fit in your world, or does it pose a threat? You're probably in a different situation.
We're permanent tree crops, yeah. So I will say that I think technology and innovation is, I mean, we have to innovate. We're looking and seeing what's happening climate-wise, and it'd be ridiculous to say that we shouldn't be innovating. We need to be innovating, and we need to be thinking of everything and trying things out. We actually have tried growing in soilless media. About maybe a decade ago, my dad started growing in soilless media, citrus and some tropicals in greenhouses. And so we did a bunch of trials, and they were really successful. I mean, what it comes down to is resources. So, I mean, when we look and see what it costs to ship produce across the country right now, a truck is so expensive. And so, and water in California, you know, it's a challenge. So as we see, at some point, I can see where the economics might work out. I mean, right now, the trials that we did with tree crops, the economics are nowhere near working out. But I wouldn't say that, you know, maybe one day they will work out. Maybe one day it will be more of a necessity.
Yeah, for us, it's not, you know, anything that's on our horizon for mainly, you know, root veg and growing underneath the soil for potatoes and carrots and onions. That's not to say it won't happen in our lifetime. It's not something. But it is amazing to go into grocery stores now, to go into the produce departments and see all of the products that are coming out of greenhouse and indoor production facilities, the technology that's there, the money that's getting behind it. It is kind of a big scary thing. And at the end of the day, when you go, you know, to buy, you know, your tomatoes or your cucumbers or whatever, you know, items that are there, and they taste good and they work and they have great shelf life, it's hard to argue. And you mix in the transportation component, you know, it's hard to argue to see that in a lot of instances that isn't going to be a very powerful force.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's a matter of time and crop by crop, right? Some are going to be ahead of others. Bianca mentioned water, and I want to touch on you know, the chronic problems of water and labor. There are some other problems that rise almost to that level that seem to be persistent, certainly in agriculture in the West and in California especially. And so what it suggests to me is that, you know, again, Vic said get out. It is amazing to me that there are people like yourselves who came back or stayed in the industry and have dedicated a career to it, especially with California, significant California operations, because the state has been so difficult to do business in, and I wish I could project that that's going to get better. I don't think it will. So the question I guess I have is as you look at, especially for the San Joaquin Valley, but throughout the West, chronic water shortages, worsening water shortages, climate change impacting not just precip patterns, but probably pest and disease patterns as well. How are you starting to think over the horizon about production methods, locations, diversity of region, maybe additional crop, either development through different technologies? We've talked a little bit in the other room about breeding technologies. So as you know, the climate is changing, we have bad policy that's getting worse, in my opinion, in California. So how do you, as people in the prime of your careers, look out over that horizon and see optimism, and how do you plan for that? Mike, why don't you start?
Yeah, I mean, in the San Joaquin Valley, it's, you know, there regions are very different from each other. Water districts can be very different from each other, so it is not it's not one broad brush. We're fortunate down in our, you know, southern end and our water district, but you're seeing a lot of things generational, once in a lifetime, people closing down or having to walk away, pulling out trees, I mean, Dave, you look and hear these stories every day. It's, I hate to go back to my dad and Vic and say get out, but for a lot of situations, it's pretty dire. And I don't know how you have a lot of optimism, but I will say this. When I first went to Western Growers in 2007, 2008 with Tom Nassif, they walked in that room and they said, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, this is not a fun industry and it's going to be tough and we're going to have our challenges. And here we are today in 2021 and 22, and we're still fighting. So I think we'll figure this one out too, right?
Yeah, I think that's one of the wonderful things about our industry is we are eternally optimistic. And
some would say foolishly.
Maybe so.
Yeah. Not me. I would say that. Some might say that.
Yeah, I don't know. Short memories. But one thing that we're doing is, and this has been, you know, happening for quite a while in our family operation, is there was the move to drip and then drip irrigation, and then the move to more high density plantings. High density, keeping the root ball smaller, watering multiple times a day instead of multiple times a week. And really, you know, instead of, actually I was driving out in Fresno County the other day, and I saw, this was a couple months ago, and I saw someone was still flood irrigating. And I'm like, man, we've come so far from this. Why is this still happening? I mean, we use probably 90% less water than we did on our citrus crops a decade, 15 years ago. So I think there's been a lot of that innovation. We'll need to continue that innovation. I will say that it kind of felt here over and over. We hear people say, "Oh, water's tough. You know, these things are tough." And last year was the first year I really acutely felt that. My favorite ranch, the Well Ran Dry, and we felt that it was coming. So we were going to be digging a new well, but. And we were able to get water. It didn't have water for a couple weeks. And I remember I called my dad and I just said, do whatever you can do. This is it's my grandparents' home ranch. It's a very special ranch to me. And I said, if we have to sacrifice other ranches to save this ranch, this is the one I want to save. Please don't let this one go. And that was tough. And it was I think that we're going to see more of that. And so we just need to keep innovating and fighting for good policy.
I think for the avocado industry, that's mainly why we go south. You know, Guatemala, we have too much water. Peru, there's a big river going through our ranches. So that's why we diversify. But to Bianca's points, what we do farm here, and actually all over the globe, it's, you know, fully automated micro drip or drip sprinklers. And, you know, more often in Peru, we irrigate four times a day. It's all hooked to a tensiometer so the tree tells you exactly when it's thirsty. So we are becoming a lot more efficient. For us, one of the problems right now is it's actually coming out of the UK, is restaurants are actually trying to boycott avocados because we use too much water. And they have a bunch of false information, so we're fighting that. But if you divide the yields that we get compared to the water usage, it's actually pretty low, you know, compared to beef or any of those other commodities. So we're actually getting it from both sides right now on the European side. But
yeah, when California's last drought, 2012 to 2016, and when some of our friends in the environmental community used almonds as the water hog, right? Yeah. 8 gallons per almond was the amount, and so we did some quick research and realized that it takes 10 gallons of water to produce a microchip. And so we started asking the question: did any of you complain when California was still producing microchips at 10 gallons per microchip, and exporting them abroad? And of course, no, they didn't complain about that. So we're just special; we get special attention. So let me ask you, because Bianca said, you know, we got to keep innovating to survive these challenges and thrive. And Michael, you're right. I mean, we complain a lot for good reason, but here we are still fighting.
Right.
But it gets harder and harder. And so I guess the question is, does that innovation, especially I would think for organic production, where you have by definition fewer tools in the toolbox, does that demand to innovate require so much capital that small can't survive, to put it really bluntly, especially in California?
I don't think so. I think it will take time for it to maybe trickle down in some cases, depending on the size of the farm. But I think that, you know, that is the wonderful thing about this industry, is whether we like it or not, we do share knowledge, we do share ideas, concepts. And if a guy invents something for me, because, you know, we're trying to figure out a way to mechanically pack sweet potatoes, guess what? If he makes that mousetrap, guess what he's going to go and do? He's going to go sell that mousetrap to somebody else. He's not just making one for me and that's it. So the really great thing about the industry is when we do innovate, the business really dictates that that innovation, it starts up here, but eventually it does make its way down. And so I don't think it's going to be a case of where just, you know, the players at the top get to reap that reward and others do not.
But we are seeing quite a bit of consolidation in the industry, and that's not a new thing, but I sense that it's accelerating because of water pressure in the San Joaquin Valley especially. You agree with that?
No, absolutely. I mean, and retailers are actually asking for a lot of consolidation from their suppliers. So it's not just a business reality. It's also the fact that, as you know, needing to sell and market these goods, a lot of the people that you're talking to only want to talk to one or two people a year. So the consolidation, not just on the business side, but really from the logistical sales and marketing side, that's, you know that probably having 10 growers that by themselves, they probably couldn't do it. They need to go to someplace where that one person, you know, can help all of them.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that's really why Fruit World started. We don't want to see family growers not be able to survive and thrive in this industry. We think there's a place for everybody. And going back to the storytelling part, stories are important. Consumers want stories and they want to connect. And so, you know, we need larger companies and we need smaller companies and we need family businesses. And I think that to your point, that there's innovation, and sometimes it starts with one person, sometimes it starts with a larger company, but in ag we see that it gets passed down.
Yeah, I think for mission or the industry on the packing side, you know, innovation is actually fairly cheap when you look at the minimum wage or the amount of complaints you get from one person. So if we can put in one or two machines and get rid of 20 people, that's 20 less headaches I have. So I think it's, we're trying to automate as much as possible, because the minimum wage thing is not going to stop, I don't think, with inflation and stuff like that. And you know, machines work on Christmas, they don't complain, so it's an easy decision for us.
There are so many possible jokes, but I'm going to resist the temptation. A couple minutes left. I want to ask you all to think about what you would like to see, what advice you would impart to the generation that will come after you. So one of these days, you're going to be sitting up here or out there listening to Michael, your kids, hopefully will be in the business.
Yeah.
What would you impart to them? And well, will you encourage them to get out, like your dad encouraged both of you and Vic encouraged you to walk away?
Probably. No, but honestly, I think it really is, do you want to sign up for this? And, you know, somebody said it about the hard work, the one constant, the one thing. And that is, if you want to do the hard work, then this is a fantastic world to be in. It is a relationship business. And there's no better industry. I have friends in every industry from A to Z. And I think they're all jealous, really, about the stories they hear from when we go to these shows and the customers that come in and really the product that we're about and what we produce. I mean, the other one thing I would say is what's always gonna be great about this is we have the best job in the world to produce this food for people. And fresh food will always be the most important thing to the health of our bodies and our families. So if you wanna sign up for this and do this work, jump on board.
Yeah, we're creating Fruit World with the hope that that we don't push the next generation out, and that if they want to come in, that they see that they can actually have a great life in produce. And it's hard, but it's totally rewarding. And I have friends who work in tech, and you know, we talk a lot about our end product, and how cool is it that we're doing something that is a necessity for everybody in this room, everybody on this planet. And it's very rewarding work. I think we're all a little bit crazy, but it's very rewarding work. And I would say to the next generation, don't be jaded. Like, there's opportunity that, if, you know, for all the challenges that we experience, I mean, look at the trade show floor here. For all the challenges we experience, there's innovation to combat that. And there's so much opportunity, and there's, I mean, for a little company like ours, look at the opportunity that we've had to come in and shake things up. We're six people right now. We're not a big company. So tons of opportunity, tons of room for growth. Don't get jaded.
Excellent.
Yeah, I think
don't bring us down, Keith.
Yeah, don't bring us down.
Pressure. 29 seconds.
If I do this, cut his mic.
No, I think the advice I would give a young person entering our industry is just to be open-minded, and, you know, don't take 8 years to admit you're wrong. Because if we would have solved this 8 years ago, we would be in a different position in Europe. And, you know, change is going to happen. So for every problem, there is a solution. And for us, you know, we can't really grow in California because the price per acre is 200,000. You know, we're fighting with the housing, San Diego County, all Oceanside, basically. So, you know, entering countries that there's opportunities, you know, don't be scared. We've gone into Guatemala and there wasn't any avocados there. So it's just risk reward, and, you know, measure that. And usually, like Vic says, 9 out of 10, it doesn't work. But if you hit that one home run, you're good.
Well, thank you. I love all of those responses. I said at the beginning how much I was looking forward to this discussion, because I've had the opportunity to work with two of these three for the last number of years, and many of their cohorts in their generation. And for someone in my position, it's easy to get jaded. It's easy to get down and not see opportunity over the horizon. But I've learned that this generation has a very different view. They are optimistic, they are determined, they are anything but jaded, and they approach every problem as an opportunity to find solutions and get even better. And I just think that is such a remarkable characteristic that will carry the industry forward boldly and well. And so I thank you all for sharing all of your insights and your backgrounds with us, and hope you all join me in thanking our panelists for joining us today.